Now, welcome to our CoVBeat webinars. And this is our third webinar, or this is our fourth webinar. Our first webinar, and we hold these webinars every 2 weeks. Our first webinar was a discussion on long COVID. Our second webinar, we had a neurologist and a psychologist, and we spoke about the brain and emotions. In the third webinar, we had a gastroenterologist and a nutritionist, and we spoke about digestive disorders and their remedies. And today, in our fourth webinar, we have our topic is post-COVID fatigue and management, and we have two very interesting speakers who will talk on this subject. One is a specialist on internal medicine, and the second is our psychologist. Now, first, let me introduce you to our internal medicine specialist, Dr. Slavika. This is Dr. Slavika Vukovic. Now, Dr. Slavika did her medical studies in the University of Belgrade. She completed her studies in 1992 and has 20 years of vast experience in outpatient diagnostics and disease management. She has organized virtual hospital CMEs in several countries, Serbia, Bosnia, Bulgaria, Albania, amongst others. She is an author and the organizer of the Virtual Hospital Simulator in Media. And this is required by law for doctors in some parts of Europe and certified by the Serbian health authorities. She has been teaching in several universities in Germany, the University of Freiburg, Leipzig, Munster, and Hanover. And she has also associated with the German Armed Forces. Dr. Slavika speaks several languages: Serbian, Croatian, Bulgarian, Russian, and fortunately for us, also English. So I now hand over to Dr. Slavika, who will be enlightening us on this very complex subject of post-COVID fatigue. I tried to read up a little bit on post-COVID fatigue last evening, and I was thoroughly confused. So I am now waiting for Dr. Slavika to enlighten us. Dr. Slavika.
Good morning. I am really glad that I have a chance to address all of you and speak about common medical issue that we and our patients are facing during the COVID pandemic. Let me first share the screen. After successfully done diagnosed of COVID-19 and the treatment of our patients, either supportive or with the specific recommended protocols, we have our patients still coming in the OPD, outpatient department, with the main complaint of profound and persistent fatigue and tiredness that is lasting for several weeks and even months, followed by fear, anxiety, and or depression. This is seriously affecting regular daily activities and postponing the patients being back to normal. What is the post-viral fatigue? In our clinical practice, we could see in a patient after any type of viral infection, mostly after infections with Epstein-Barr virus, cytomegalovirus, enterovirus, and herpes virus. Many people are experiencing persistent profound fatigue for a few weeks or even a month after recovery. For some patients, the fog never lifts. many scientists are finding the viral infections as a primary cause of chronic fatigue syndrome. This long-term condition is characterized by unexplained tiredness that is worsened by exertion, cognitive dysfunction, sore joint, and flu-like symptoms that is seriously affecting daily functioning in a period more than 6 months. Unfortunately, the exact pathogenesis is still unknown. For recognized abnormalities in immune response, like overactive immune activity, cytokines, presence of antibodies such as rheumatic factor, anti-thyroid antibodies, anti-smooth muscles antibodies, chronic fatigue syndrome was originally named myalgic encephalomyelitis because of skeletal muscles component manifesting as a chronic fatigue and an encephalitic component manifesting as cognitive dysfunction. However, there is a lack of encephalomyelitis in laboratory findings and imaging studies, and myalgia is not the main symptom in this disease. Chronic fatigue syndrome, this is important, it's a biological illness, not a psychological disorder. Finally, the cause is still unknown and there are no specific tests that we can do to simply just a second to change. And direct tests are not existing to diagnose chronic fatigue syndrome. The diagnosis is based on the presence of cognitive dysfunction, which is absent in almost all other fatigue-produced disorder. The clinicians have diagnostic criteria to follow, such as presence of three symptoms with moderate to severe intensity at least 50% of the time for more than 6 months. What are those three main symptoms? Now we are back to our topic. This is fatigue. A noticeable decrease or impairment in performing regular daily activities that the patient was performing before onset of the illness. Patients often report a history of flu-like infection that precipitated the prolonged state of fatigue. The second is post-exertional malaise, or PEM. This is the worsening of the symptoms after exposure to the stressful situation that the patient was well tolerating before. On the third place is unrefreshing sleep. Patient feels tired after a normal night's sleep. Criterion fulfillment requires presence of the mentioned three main symptoms plus one of the next, and this is cognitive impairment. That means the problem with the memory, concentration, that worsen by exertion, efforts, or stress. The next is also orthostatic intolerance or worsening the symptom in the upright position. That means hypertension, dizziness, and else. In our clinic, we are seeing the patients coming usually, just to explain a little bit about those symptoms, are coming with the polymorphic symptoms, including that orthostatic, low blood pressure, hypertension, fatigue, post-exertional malaise, and even diarrhea. Chronic fatigue syndrome is more common in females, and the average onset is 33 years, although have been reported in patients younger than 10 years and older than 70. Clinical presentation is often with no abnormalities at all. many patients have that low blood pressure in upright position. And we can find some small, painless, movable lymph nodes in the regions of the neck, axillary, and inguinal region. In the laboratory findings, there are normal results, and we are using them just to diagnose some underlying conditions. Necessary analyses are complete blood count, electrolytes, liver and renal function tests, glucose, thyroid function tests, some cultures, ECG, cardiopulmonary exercise tests, tilt table tests. So a lot of tests we could do just to find a treatable underlying condition. So what is the treatment and management of a chronic fatigue syndrome? Treatment is supportive and it focuses on symptom relief. There are several control trials were done regarding graded activities and cognitive behavior therapy. And after the both have been analyzed, still there is no common strategy for the treatment of chronic fatigue syndrome. Graded exercise therapy is improving the patient's physical function in the terms of sleep disorder and general health, but it's not affecting the outcome of the pain, anxiety, depression, and the quality of life. Chronic fatigue syndrome cannot be cured. It has its remissions and relapses, and its symptoms can persist several months up to several years. One prospective study suggests that approximately 50% of patients with a chronic fatigue syndrome can return to part-time or full-time work. And the good outcomes are associated with the less fatigue severity at the baseline. Analyzing recovered patients from COVID-19 infections, now we are coming to the topic. I just introduced one condition that we are comparing today. And around 1 in 10 of our patients after COVID-19 are experiencing post-viral symptoms at least 3 months later, such as severe fatigue, pain, neurocognitive disability, difficulty concentrating, sleep problems, dyspnea. In laboratory findings, we could see still mildly elevated C-reactive protein. On the chest X-ray, some changes could still be present. How to confirm presence of COVID fatigue syndrome? And again, like in the chronic fatigue syndrome, there is no specific test. Physician must rule out any possible treatable underlying condition like electrolytes imbalance, anemia, iron deficiency, vitamin deficiency, glucose level, if there is something to correct, dehydration. According to the World Health Organization, people who are recovering from severe illness or who have a long COVID may require also rehabilitation to manage the after effects of COVID-19. And this includes lung damage, heart damage, such as myocarditis or pericarditis, cognitive impairment that affects memory and concentration, conditions that affect blood vessels such as clotting, lasting effects from complications such as a heart attack, stroke, or pulmonary embolism, anxiety, depression, muscle or joint pain, and chronic fatigue, even in the World Health Organization, are suggesting a proper rehabilitation. So there is a lot of overlap with the chronic fatigue syndrome, but it is not yet possible to say, is it the same condition? Various small studies are done and it's showing at the fact in the metabolic energy production in the chronic fatigue syndrome at the cellular level, is it the same issue? It in the post-COVID fatigue syndrome is not clear because no one had really enough time to study that. What could be in the future? We could expect much more acceptance about this overlap between post-COVID fatigue syndrome and the chronic fatigue syndrome, and more finance for research that could result in the better treatment options for both categories. Also, we could expect that the virus SARS-CoV-2 could be added to the viral agent list causing a chronic fatigue syndrome. In the meantime, what we could suggest to our patients to overcome post-COVID syndrome is the healthy lifestyle, regular, well-balanced meals. And I think that the nutritionist will tell in details what that means. Hydration, vitamin supplementation. Very important is the good sleep routine. Post-COVID cardiovascular rehabilitation, if it's needed. Then carefully graded exercise to avoid post-exertional malaise. And the most important is the psychological support. Everywhere in the world, there are special rehabilitation centers that have organized teams for the post-COVID patients. Our RAC hospital has also a specialist team oriented to perform the best quality support for our patients to regain their physical and cognitive abilities after illnesses. If you are having a post-COVID fatigue syndrome or long COVID, please don't hesitate to approach to our team members for any additional questions. We will guide you till you restore your normal life. So this is for now. And if you have any additional questions, I will be here to answer.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Slavika. That was very interesting and very enlightening. Very enlightening. I tried to understand post-COVID fatigue last evening. I did not succeed, but I have some understanding of post-COVID fatigue right now. Now, I have questions which I will ask in the question answer session, and any of our listeners who have questions, we have a 15-minute question answer session after the second speaker. We will be happy to direct your questions to both our speakers. And now, ladies and gentlemen, my dear colleagues who are listening in, allow me to introduce you to our second speaker. Now you may recall that one of the things that Dr. Slavika said is, and most importantly, psychological support. She did speak about exercise and nutrition, but Dr. Slavika did say a good psychologist will help you in reducing your stress, anxiety, and depression in case they are the symptoms that you have. And we have exactly the right person for you. Now, allow me to introduce, dear friends, allow me to introduce our clinical psychologist from RAC Hospital, Ms. Pratiksha Shetty. Now, Pratiksha has completed two master's certifications. She has completed a Master of Science in Psychology and her Master's of Philosophy in Clinical Psychology. And both these subjects, as I see, were done from NIMHANS, which is India's leading institute or university in the field of psychology and psychiatry. She has 8 to 10 years of clinical and teaching experience, some of which she has spent with us, and she is a faculty with the RAC Health and Medical Sciences University, which is next door to our building. Pratiksha, who I know personally, specializes in marital therapy, that is advice to individuals like me who are married, but that's not the reason why I met Pratiksha. I met Pratiksha for academic programs, but she does specialize in marital therapy, suicide and self-harm, mental illness, and addictive behaviors. Now, that is one side of Pratiksha's personality. The other side of Pratiksha's personality is her special interests, which all tend to relate to positive psychology, which is a new and emerging field in our medical program. So she talks in terms of hope, resilience, self-image, emotionally focused therapy, mental health literacy. And I'll request Pratiksha to spend the next 20 minutes with us talking about how we can manage this very difficult aspect of post-COVID fatigue. Yes, Pratiksha, thank you.
Thank you, Professor, for the lovely introduction. We are going to look at briefly what are the psychological strategies that you can do for your loved ones or if you are suffering from post-COVID fatigue. Let's have a brief overview of what exactly is post-COVID fatigue, particularly from a point of view. Some of the things Dr. Slavika has already covered, so I'm not going to go into much details. The overview of the presentation is basically looking at how else fatigue can manifest. From a psychological perspective, what would post-COVID fatigue look like and what are the strategies that you can use in yourself and your loved ones when it comes to reports of fatigue? As Dr. Slavika has already pointed out, we are learning as we go. A lot of what we know so far has been replicated or has been understood in terms of what is chronic fatigue syndrome, what is ME, what was the earlier coronavirus outbreaks in 2002 and 2012. From those earlier outbreaks, we are trying to extrapolate our learnings to the current COVID-19 outbreak, which is going on in several countries. A number of studies have pointed out that fatigue as one symptom, it is present in up to 60 to 72% of patients. Now you have to remember this percentage, 60 to 72% has been noted in admitted patients across the world. So you have studies in USA, you have studies in UK, you have studies in Italy. So this is something that is consistently reported across the world. And this is only for patients who are admitted. So we have very little data to see what fatigue would look like for mild cases, people who have been isolated at home or people who were never admitted. So that data is missing, but 60 to 72 is a huge prevalence statistics. Why should we look at fatigue? For obvious reasons that you care about your health status. There's also a national level interest because a lot of people don't feel comfortable enough. They don't feel ready enough to go back to work. And in that sense, your work productivity would decline. People would have a lot more absence taken. And that could affect in turn overall on our healthcare system because more and more of these patients who have had COVID would keep coming back to healthcare because they are still struggling 4 to 6 weeks or even months after having come out from the COVID-19 infection. certain things that can also look like COVID. A lot of patients who we have seen in outpatient department complain about how they are not able to get out of bed, that they prefer bed rest, they don't feel like doing anything, or they may complain of pain, particularly headaches. They may complain of brain fog, not being able to focus on certain things, not being able to decide. Everything seems overwhelming for them. Typically, fatigue can present as drowsiness. Patients may yawn more often. They may feel tired more often. They may not be able to exercise the way they were doing. Maybe they go for a walk and they start panting. They start feeling out of breath. So there are different manifestations of fatigue. It is not necessary that a patient or someone with post-COVID sequelae should complain of being tired or being exhausted. It can come up in different ways, and that is something that all of us need to recognize in ourselves and in others. From a psychological point of view, there's an established model for a post-COVID fatigue, which I'm going to explain step by step. Whenever you think of any effort put into any cognitive or mental task, there are a number of variables that would determine how tired you feel or how exhausted or fatigued you feel. So the factors are, one is the task dependence, the environment that you're working in, your physical, mental abilities, and the other conditions. Take, for example, walking. Now, walking is something that is purely physical, something that is purely motor. So there's not much thinking, not much planning involved, except that you have to think about how many minutes do you have to walk in what direction. So that's a purely motor physical task. Now, the environment in which you go for a walk, right now it is hot outside. There's hot air, there's dust storm, some of you are fasting. So that would be an environmental factor. Combined with that is your post-COVID status. What is your lung functioning like? Do you have other comorbid medical conditions? Are you able to concentrate on tasks? Do you feel well equipped to go for a walk of 30 minutes or even less? So that put together, it is mediated by a psychological factor, a psychological variable. Now, a psychological variable, that is a whole spectrum of variables. It can include everything from your personality, the way you cope with your struggles, your own history of mental health concerns. Are you a worrier? Are you sensitive? Are you shy? Are you someone who don't talk much to people? You keep it to yourself. So these coping strategies, personality, family history, history of mental health concern, how did you deal with the COVID infection, all that put together would result in post-COVID fatigue. So fatigue is not an isolated symptom. It needs to be seen in the context of which it occurs. Remember that along with the fatigue, along with your changed medical status, changed neurological status, you're expected to go back to work. And the COVID-19 pandemic is still going on in different proportions in different countries. So you may be worried about that. You may be worried about people back home. You may be worried about going to work in a non-phased fashion, restricted movement, the fact that you have to wear masks, PPE, all those would add up to the stress. So the stress plus your medical condition plus physical challenges that could put together would result in post-COVID fatigue. That is, as psychologists, we conceptualize it this way. So if this is a conceptualization, what is the management plan? So for today's webinar, we'll be looking at mainly behavioral strategies and cognitive strategies. That is something that we routinely practice in our patients, in our patients and inpatients. Just like Dr. Slavika discussed earlier, there are two kinds of fatigue. One is where you do an activity and then you feel tired. Or there's another kind of fatigue where you generally feel tired. You generally feel unwell and you can't pinpoint why you're feeling tired or why you're feeling exhausted. So this can be technically called as exercise intolerance or post-exertional malaise, or PEM, as she's spoken about. Now, as human beings, we tend to have high level of activities or no activities. Generally, we don't go in between. Take, for example, going for the gym. You may go for 2 days or you may work out for 2 hours. And then the next rest of the week, you don't want to go to the gym because you're hurting. Same thing happens with patients with post-COVID fatigue. They may do a lot of activities, a lot of energy invested activities on their good days. Maybe they do it in the morning. So they, by 12 in the noon, they are exhausted and they need to take a nap. And the nap is not good enough. So that adds on to the fatigue. Or in the other spectrum, they may not do anything at all. So they oscillate between doing too much and doing nothing. So this boom and bust pattern is typically seen with anyone struggling with a medical condition, in particular, someone with post-COVID fatigue or chronic fatigue syndrome, where they're not able to stabilize the level of activity. This all or nothing is what adds on to the fatigue, and it adds on to the anxiety that people may experience. So what can we do in the sense of strategies? Typically, there are two main techniques. One is the pacing technique and the other is graded exercise. Now, pacing technique, as the word suggests, it is something that you spread out. So let's say you have 4 different activities, both cognitive, physical, motor, that you need to do in a day. Spread it out throughout the day. Don't make it seem that you need to do everything in the morning or you need to do everything in the evening. Spread it out throughout the day, throughout the week, so that you're not feeling overwhelmed. So the mantra is activity, rest, repeat. Do not get too overwhelmed. If there are certain things that you no longer are able to do, please delegate to others, your family members, people who are supportive, your well-wishers, delegate till you feel a lot better. There are other things, other ways that you can organize your environment too. For example, someone with very severe fatigue, those patients who are in ICU or who were bedridden for quite some time, they may not have the muscle strength or the lung capacity to go for a jog or to do cardio aerobic exercises. So in that case, you may need a lot more small interventions. For instance, if a task requires you to stand and do something, try adapting it. Try using a stool or a chair, particularly in the washroom area. Make sure things are nearby so that you don't have to go back and forth. Because sometimes when you have severe fatigue, even going to the washroom or going shopping can add up to the fatigue. So wherever possible, try to plan your physical activities or thinking activities so that there's a lot less effort put and a lot of adaptations and tricks that you employ to make sure that you don't spend that much energy and you save that energy for a lot more important things. In terms of graded exercise, again, if you are equipped to go for a walk, go for a workout, go for a gym, do it in a graded fashion, a step-by-step fashion. You need to assess where you are at. Are you still struggling with decreased lung capacity? Do you have neuropsychological deficits? Are you medically fit to do some of the exercises your therapist may ask you to? Now, incorporating that, remember what you were pre-COVID. If you're someone who does not like exercise, if you're someone who does not like going for the gym, think of other strategies, maybe a sport, maybe swimming, maybe going for a walk with someone. So these strategies combined together would help you to increase the level of activity. Again, when you're setting goals, think of SMART goals, something that is very specific, something that is very measurable, something that is very achievable, realistic, and time-bound. If, for example, if you're thinking of going for a 2-kilometer walk, remember you have to come back 2 kilometers. So don't go for a walk which means that you're too tired to come back. It should not be that you need a taxi to come back or you need to call some pick me up, right? So analyze that where you're at and understand what your body needs, how much you're capable of, and ask for help wherever possible. For strategies when it comes to your mood or your worries, this is something again that is very normal, that is expected. So none of this is pathological per se. None of this is abnormal. You have gone through a COVID infection, which in a lot of cases has a neuropsychological deficit. So there's nothing that says that you have anxiety or depression. Yes, people do suffer from it, but in a lot of sense, there are negative thoughts that can come up, particularly if you're still confined to your home, or if you're not able to move around, or if you have lost your job. So number of negative thoughts can come up because you're cooped up, you have a lot of free time, not much to do, you can't work around. So it is expected that these negative thoughts are going to pop up. So what are the typical negative thoughts a lot of patients post-COVID discuss? Why me? Why did this happen to me? Or will I ever get better? Why even bother? Why put in this effort? Anyway, nothing is going to happen. So why even get out of bed? Why not just sleep the days away and expect things to get better? Or the usual, very common thought that people have is, this is just too hard. I'm just going to give up. So what would this look like from a clinical angle? Helplessness, hopelessness, catastrophization, where let's say you are not able to walk fast. You may start thinking that, oh, this means I will never be able to walk at my earlier speed, or I will never be able to get back to my pre-morbid function. So a bit of catastrophization can take place, where you magnify your level of difficulty and you minimize the progress. You may forget the fact that you were admitted 2 months ago, or you may forget the fact that you have made a lot of progress, but you magnify your struggles, you magnify the difficulty, which in turn would result in you feeling more tired. That in turn would make you feel a lot more low, a lot more sad, crying bored. So it's a whole cycle that generates in itself. A rumination is something that a lot of people who are bedridden or severe fatigue patients can experience, where you keep thinking the same thing again and again. Typically, ruminations are said to be like a cow chewing the cud. If you have seen cows eat, they eat something, they chew something, and then they bring it up. So it's like a stuck tape in your head. You keep thinking the same worry again and again, and you can't break the pattern. This in turn would give you less emotional energy, less coping resources to go for that walk. So fatigue, again, it is not isolated symptom. You need to put these things in perspective when you set goals for management and rehabilitation. In terms of strategies, what can you do? Now, I'm a big fan of do it yourself, everything from carpentry to gifts to mental health. So these are specific strategies which you can do even at home. One in particular is called mindfulness. There are a lot of applications out there. I have put up a list. There's mindfulness, there's calm, there's simple habit, and Headspace. Headspace is the best out there. It might be a little bit more expensive, but it's worth the effort and the money put in. So what really is mindfulness? It is basically being in the present moment, wherever you are, the immediate present. So that could mean being open to everything, particularly through your senses. What do you see? What do you hear? What do you smell? What do you taste? But you're not responding. If, for example, you're drinking coffee mindfully, you're not going to discuss in your head how bad this coffee is, or how good the coffee is, or how Starbucks has better coffee. You're just there in that moment, completely there, being completely aware, and you're suspending your thoughts, you're suspending the judgments, you're suspending the labels. So when you're completely there in that moment, it would help you break the pattern that you have established of overthinking, of worrying, of questioning everything because you're still struggling. So that gives you like a pause button. It helps you to step back and look back at your life a lot more objectively. It would also give you a lot of emotional energy, a lot of coping resources to actually invest in the tasks that you need to do. So overall, this could help with your sleep. It could help with your mood. It could help with your worries, your anxiety. So this is one technique that works for a number of areas, including concentration, planning, decision making. So I suggest if you're struggling, if you know someone who is struggling, you look up these applications which have guided instructions. They have music, so you just have to put your headphone on and do it for 10 minutes just to relax a bit more and feel a lot more capable and able to do the things that you need to do. So that is one technique. The other strategies that I recommend for everyone, regardless of their COVID status, is something called gratitude journal or thankfulness. These are based on positive psychology, which is basically you looking back to how far you have come. There's something that one of the RAK hospital staff often talks about. She was COVID positive and she was sick for a month, home isolation. So when she talks to me, she often says, I'm a COVID survivor. So this stance of victim to survivor, that is so empowering. You stop feeling sorry for yourself and you think of, yes, I survived this. But there are a lot of people who are struggling, who are in much worse shape. And you can actually be grateful and thankful. Again, not being preachy. It could be simple things. It could be the fact that you are able to breathe without any mechanical help, without any ventilation, without any doctor's help, without any rehab specialist. So that could be enough. Or you could be grateful for the fact that some of us still have a job, that you still have family members around, you still have a roof over your head. So any little thing, the idea is that this would generate a lot more positive emotion. So rather than thinking about how you can't walk fast, you would in turn think about how life is okay. It's not that bad. So you're trying to change the perspective or looking at it a bit differently. The second positive psychology intervention that I generally recommend is savoring. Think of something that you genuinely enjoy. Usually it could be food or it could be some activity that gives you a lot of pleasure. So savoring is where you intensify this pleasure component. Since we have a picture of a woman smelling a rose, if she was savoring, it would help to close your eyes. It would also help to think of it again from a sensory angle, how the rose smell, or what's the wind like, what's the weather like today? What does she see? What does she hear? What does she feel? So she's completely in that moment, and that pleasure that she gains from smelling a rose is intensified. This could be done when you're eating a very good meal or something that you really love, or doing something work-related, or even being with someone. The idea is that you immerse yourself completely in that moment, which would again generate a sense of positive emotion, a sense of thankfulness, and the worries that you have are put aside. So these strategies are not standalone strategies. When it combines with graded exercise, when it combines with reframing, perspective taking, that would help you a lot more with the motivation to go out there and start working on your goals. In terms of cognitive behavioral strategies in particular, there are two things that which all of us can do. Is one is reframe, which I've already discussed. You incorporate all information and put things in perspective. The fact that you had an illness, the fact that you survived, that you were in hospital and no longer in hospital, the fact that you have made progress. All these things would again give you the energy, the resources to move on in life, to progress from life and to learn from the struggles that you have. The second thing that is very important for us to remember for as human beings is there's a limited number of things that we can control. And I think everyone agrees this. We cannot control the weather. We cannot control how a boss behaves with us. We cannot control how many leave that is left in, as part of your annual sick leave. But what can you control? You can control the time that you spend, how you spend that time, how you modify the thoughts, what goals that you set for yourself. So the important thing patients with COVID fatigue have to remember is focus on the positives, focus on the strengths, focus on the learnings and the growth that has come up because of this COVID. It will be hard. I'm not saying that is something that you can just do it, but it's worth trying because it is going to have a long-term benefit, not just recovering from post-COVID sequelae. It's going to help you to bounce back first faster when you struggle later on in life. So to summarize, for all of us, the road to recovery is not one straight line. And the story of your recovery will be different from the other person. So let's not compare the fact that your friend is running a marathon. It's different for him or her. It's a different health status, mental health status. So focus on your own personal journey, your own personal recovery. See what works for you. Think of a holistic management plan. Generally, in clinical practice, we have a physician, we have psychologists, we have dietitian, we have physiotherapists. So four of us work together. And we each of us will look at what we can offer for the patient or how can the patient benefit from us. So don't just look at only the medical aspect, consider other aspects because they all go in hand. They are all very circular fashion. If you're really struggling, I suggest that you see a professional. If you feel that it's been more than 4 weeks, 6 weeks, give it 6 weeks. If you see absolutely no improvement or generally you feel that you need to talk to someone, it would be a good idea to consult your physician, consult your physiotherapist, or if you have mental health struggles, consult a psychologist. So all this put together would definitely help you to recover from post-COVID fatigue or post-COVID sequelae. So I'm going to end here now. We are open to questions, I believe. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Pratiksha. Thank you very much. That was very enlightening. I recall I've learned a lot. You've spoken about pacing techniques, you spoke about SMART goals, and most importantly, you spoke about gratitude and sphere of control. Thank you so much. We have had two excellent speakers, and you will notice that one of our speakers, Roxlavika, was from the medical space, and Pratiksha was from the health space. And this is the basic structure of our programs. We talk about the post-COVID issues with reverence from our medical colleagues and with understanding and support from our health colleagues. And now I present to you, ladies and gentlemen, Dr. Wilku. Dr. Wilku is unique. And the reason why Dr. Wilku is unique is that he is both a medical and a health professional. Dr. Wilku has done his studies in medicine, and he is also a leader in the area of health and associated with the American Council of Lifestyle Medicine. And so importantly, Dr. Wilku's son is currently studying medicine in Europe. So Dr. Wilku has not only passed on his genes, he will also pass on his knowledge, and that will be beneficial for the rest of mankind. Dr. Wilku, you might have a few questions to ask both our speakers.
Thank you, Professor, for the kind words. First of all, thank you, Dr. Slavika and Pratiksha. Both of you have given a wonderful session, and straightforward, you have pinpointed the points we should be knowing about. There are a lot of questions. We received the mails, and today in chat also we have received a few questions. Harshit Singh is asking, is there any difference between post-COVID fatigue and chronic fatigue syndrome? Dr. Slavika was mentioning about this. Again, this gentleman has asked about this question. Dr. Slavika, can you please reply to this?
Yes, there are some differences, especially in a clinical presentation. As I mentioned before, in a chronic fatigue syndrome, usually the patients are coming with the polymorphic symptoms and complaints. But when we are examining them, usually we are not finding anything that is showing a sickness. several lymph nodes could be palpated, but after COVID, we could see and hear some changes on the lung stills, on the X-ray, and the patients are coming still with the dyspnea or shortness of breath. That is the difference.
Thank you, ma'am. I think now again you have made it clear. Mr. Shohib Hussain is asking for his friend, my friend recovered from COVID three months back. He still feels lack of energy. Is it fatigue?
Yes, this is one of the signs of fatigue, and it could last several weeks or even months. So, as we mentioned, in a chronic fatigue, there is a lack of energy on the cellular level. So maybe this is the same in the post-COVID patient, but still we cannot confirm that 100%. This is a sign of a fatigue, of course.
Yeah. There was one more question which was sent in mail connected to this. I think Pratiksha, you can answer this because one person has asked. The patient who recovered is not able to concentrate, focus, and he is very much demotivated about his weakness. So can it be managed by stress management or meditation? Pratiksha, you can answer about this. Okay, we'll take another question. So one male connected to the same question that I'm asking you. Patient has recovered from COVID. But still he feels weakness and he doesn't want to do anything. He feels low of energy every time. So Dr. Stavrikar has already mentioned this is a fatigue. What about doing some psychological management like stress management, meditation, relaxation? Will it work?
Yes, definitely. I think what the person may be experiencing is some worries about his progress and recovery. So in that sense, relaxation therapy or breathing exercises, meditation would help the person feel a lot more relaxed and in general a lot more equipped to deal with the physical struggles. So yes, the answer.
Okay, fine, thank you. Mr. Vetri Francis, he has asked, is there any specific diet for fatigue? Anyone can answer, Dr. Slavika or Pratiksha? Because this is a diet thing.
Yes, I mentioned already that the well regular balanced meals are very important, and the vitamin supplementation also we are suggesting to our patients continuously for several weeks after COVID. Vitamin C, vitamin D, B complex, zinc, we can continue to support. I'm always suggesting Mediterranean diet as the best option, but it depends on the affinity of the patient. So the regular meals, well balanced. This is the.
Thank you, Mr. Tapan has given one query because he was suffering from COVID and has since 90 days of infection. Now he plans for vaccination. So his question is, is there any test to be done before vaccination, or we can go directly for vaccination?
We can always measure the antibodies level, but usually 3 to 6 months after the COVID, we can give that one booster dose to enhance the immunity. But he has to come to physician first, not directly to the vaccination.
Thank you, ma'am. One more question from Sam Kadam. What exactly causes fatigue, and is medication required to manage fatigue?
This is the most important question, and still we don't have the right answer. Only we are guessing what is the similarity with the chronic fatigue, and there is that lack of energy for sure that we are recognizing. And regarding the medication, there is no specific treatment. Everything that we are talking today about, like healthy lifestyle, supportive therapy, this is what we can do for our patients and what they can do for themselves. and we will support them. No typical or specific medication exists yet.
Thank you, ma'am. There is one more question. Bharat Rathod is asking, will meditation and relaxation help to cope with fatigue? I think already Pratiksha has mentioned about this.
Yes. So
Pratiksha, will you please take this question again?
Are you referring to the Mr. Bharat's question? Is that the question, Mr. Bharat? Will meditation relaxation help to cope with?
Yes, that is the question. Yes.
Yes. Particularly if you're experiencing low mood, or if you're worried about your recovery, or if you're worried about the future. Add on to the fact that you are struggling with dealing with the stress of going back to work, going back to university, dealing with people in general in a COVID pandemic area. So definitely it could help you to learn some strategies to be a lot more relaxed and bounce back faster from any fatigue that you experience.
Dr. Wilco, are you asking questions? Because I can't hear you.
Sorry. Mr. Harsher Singh is asking, does fatigue causes any chronic disease? And is it necessary to worry about this? I think Dr. Slavika can answer this.
No, the chronic fatigue is not causing any specific disease, but of course it's affecting the quality of life, and that is the reason to be a little bit worried. But with our support, the patients could come back to the normal life.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. One more question: is recurrent sore throat is a symptom of post-COVID fatigue?
It could be one of the signs of the post-COVID fatigue, but the patient should come to the physician. Because we need to rule out any underlying treatable condition. If there is a bacterial pharyngitis, we have a treatment for that. So it could be the sign, but we need to rule out underlying treatable condition.
Thank you, ma'am. I think there is no more question just for now. If you, in one line or one sentence, you can, Dr. Slavika and Pratiksha, both of you can give one advice, single statement advice. Dr. Slavika first.
My advice: to be patient and optimistic, and to rely on us, on physicians to help you to restore your life back.
Yeah, Pratiksha, please.
I think mine is the same. Summer, patience. Don't compare with anyone. You have your own personal journey of recovery. Patience and hope.
You have to have patience, right?
Yes, of course.
I received one WhatsApp. What will be the next steps for Professor Kennedy? What will be the next webinar coming up? I think we are planning for breathing exercises and this lung issues. Professor Kennedy will be putting words on this.
I noticed that Dr. Slavika as well as Pratiksha was asked to give a single line statement on how they could help, or their impression of how post-COVID fatigue can be best managed. And I am ever so impressed with the single line statement. It is so difficult from vast knowledge to bring it down to a single microscopic iota. It is so difficult. But I agree with both our speakers that the best advice that you can get is to consult your specialist. Please consult your doctor if you are not feeling well. Your doctor will evaluate everything, give her advice, and then pass you on to the health professional who will support the entire therapy. That is the best advice that we can give. Now, coming to the question that Dr. Wilco posed to me as to what is our next seminar. Colleagues and friends, we have this seminar every 2 weeks. And as I mentioned, we've had digestive disorders, we've had the brain and emotions, we've had other such aspects that we've discussed, and today we've had fatigue. We are proposing, and there is a committee that sits on this, we are proposing to talk about respiratory dysfunction and breathing techniques as our next session. So we are talking to our Director of Medical Services, and she would give us all the support that is required, but it will very likely be respiratory dysfunction and its management would be the next session. And friends, I cannot thank Dr. Savika and Pratiksha and Dr. Wilku enough, but my thanks extend beyond my speakers to my technical support team, my IT colleagues who have helped us to keep this function going. I would like to thank all our participants. We've had an abundant number of participants, over 80 by my reckoning in this seminar and in this webinar, and that is excellent. I would like to thank all our participants for listening in. And friends, have a look at your screen. You will notice that we have a brochure there, which right at the bottom talks about support at rackhospitalrehab.com. Now, that is in case you have questions. You do not need to wait for the webinar for your questions to be answered. Send them in to us, and we will direct them to Pratiksha or Slavika or Dr. Shweta or Dr. Savita or Dr. Any of the specialists. Please feel free to ask the questions. That is one. And secondly, remember that all our sessions are recorded and put up in our portal. So just log into www.rackhospitalrehab.com. It's at the bottom of your screen, and you will see this session as well as the earlier sessions recorded up there for your review. Now, with this, friends, thank you very, very much, and we'll see you in 2 or 3 weeks for the next session. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you, Dr. Slavika. Thank you, Pratiksha.